Southern Africa has long been scarred by colonial rule and racial oppression, by white minorities ruling black majorities. Freedom reached Southern Africa only in this generation. Britain's first colony to win independence in Southern Africa was Tanzania in 1961. In 1964, Malawi followed, and a few months after that, Zambia was free. By 1966, so too was Botswana. But Britain's oldest ally, Portugal, ruled by a dictatorship, ignored the African demand for freedom. Her colonies had to fight for it. In Mozambique, the struggle was long and bloody. Mozambique's independence changed the map once more, but it was upheaval in another of Portugal's colonies which brought Southern Africa to the centre of the world stage, Angola. The defeat of their side in Angola, the new map of Southern Africa thus created, forced the West to change tactics. Now only three bastions of white supremacy remained: Namibia, South Africa, and, most urgently, Rhodesia. At the start of the Kissinger mission last week, President Nyerere had been pessimistic. But 2 days ago, when Dr. Kissinger returned to report to him on his talks with Dr. Vorster and Mr. Smith in South Africa, Nyerere broke the news that victory seemed imminent. Afterwards, in his only television interview since Dr. Kissinger's arrival in Africa, President Nyerere discussed the mission in detail.
Kissinger tells me that next Friday he expects a statement from Mr. Smith which accepts not just the principle of majority rule, but majority rule within the terms expressed by Mr. Callaghan in his conditions. And these terms was independence on the basis of majority rule in 2 years, 18 months, 16 months. Now, if Kissinger expects Smith to say this, then I must say either he has converted him, which is not likely, or he has made the alternatives look very grim indeed to him.
Do you expect Mr. Smith to say this, that he accepts majority rule, not only majority rule, but within 2 years at the outside?
Well, look, if Dr. Kissinger tells me that he expects Smith to say this, I must believe Dr. Kissinger. I don't believe Smith. So my optimism is based upon what Kissinger has told me, upon Kissinger's integrity, and upon American power.
What effective pressure can the Americans put on Smith that the British couldn't?
South Africa supports Smith. Without South Africa, really, Smith is not likely to last for very long. The Americans have the necessary economic, the necessary power to say to the South Africans, you are the supporters of Smith. Stop supporting Smith.
Or else?
Or else.
And that's what's been said, you believe?
If it has not been said, then my optimism is unfounded, because I'm saying Smith can only accept majority rule under pressure. He cannot be converted to majority rule.
If Smith on Friday does say, I accept majority rule, how long before a majority government will be in power, transitionally perhaps, in Rhodesia, which will then become Zimbabwe?
This depends upon the length of the constitutional talks. And if I understand it, one of the conditions Mr. Callaghan laid down was that once a constitutional conference has been called, he expects that it's going to reach its decisions quickly. And one is not going to have a protracted, long constitutional conference. One of the things that the constitutional conference must agree are the terms for the establishment of a provisional government. It would be established immediately. You expect that this government would be established immediately after the talks.
So we're talking about a matter of weeks, in your view?
I should think so, if this is my understanding. You say you accept majority rule, the British call a constitutional conference. A constitutional conference worked out the program, and the program includes this formation of a provisional government. I should expect, unless one wants the war to go on for another year or so,
that the provisional government would have to be an African majority government for it to be acceptable to you?
It has to be. It has to be. It's not the independence government, but it is an African government. It has a majority of African. It's led by Africans and it has a majority.
How long does the guerrilla war in Rhodesia now go on for?
Until you have formed that provisional government. That's why I repeat, it is important to bring the talks to an end as soon as possible, because it is that government which calls off the war. Nobody else can call off that war.
Mr. President, do you have anything to say to the white minority in Rhodesia?
I don't know what I can say. It's very difficult what to say. We mean it when we say that we want to establish non-racial societies. The whites in Southern Africa have laid down the conditions under which they will live in Africa. And their condition is that they must dominate. And I'm saying on that condition, really, they have no future in Africa. This is a condition which inevitably puts them in confrontation with the majority of the people of Africa. But if they accept to live in Africa on the basis of equality, they ask for nothing that a human being anywhere does not ask, then there is no reason why they shouldn't live in Africa just like anybody else.
Why was it then that you suggested, you proposed the fund of money to go to white settlers who wanted to leave after independence?
Because I'm being completely realistic that these people don't accept majority rule. A large number of them, a majority of that minority does not accept majority rule. And if we agree that majority rule is coming in any case, these people will leave in any case, and therefore better that they leave now than that they fight and fight and fight and leave at the end of a long and terrible war. A minority will stay, and usually when this minority which stays does not ask for special guarantees. They stay as ordinary human beings.
What is your reaction to the view that white people should be given special financial and other guarantees to stay in Zimbabwe?
I think it is absurd. I think it's absurd. That's why I'm saying, really, one should do on a larger scale in Zimbabwe what one did on a smaller scale in Kenya. You bought them off. Those who didn't want to stay in that country were bought off. You didn't pay them to stay. What is the idea of paying a person to stay in a country in which he says, this is my country anyway, I'm going to stay here? You don't pay him to stay. You pay him to start a new way of life elsewhere because he doesn't want to live here under majority rule.
Do you believe that as a consequence of Dr. Kissinger's initiative, Western interests have been strengthened in Southern Africa?
I believe Dr. Kissinger is right in saying if you want to work for American interests or Western interests in Southern Africa, throw your weight on the side of those who are working for majority rule. If you don't, and the war goes on, and we have said we can't give these people arms to fight, they will achieve their independence only through the support which they get from the communist countries. And this is not in the interest of the Western powers. So I suppose he's right in doing this, but I'm saying, so what? I want his pressure. I want American pressure. I want American pressure on the side of majority rule. And I have no intention of quarreling with Americans. What I'm interested in is majority rule in Southern Africa.
One of the things that Dr. Kissinger said in Washington before he came here was that part of the process in his mind was to arrest, was his term, the radicalization of Africa, which he said would have profound impact in the Middle East and Europe and elsewhere. Yes. Has he been successful in your judgment?
On this one, I think he's wrong. It would be wrong for me not to say this. He's wrong. You can't set out in Africa on the basis of arresting radicalization. We are going to radicalize Africa. If you set out to stop radicalization, you are setting out for a confrontation with future Africa. Future Africa must be radicalized. We must change Africa, and Africa cannot be changed without being radicalized. If you are going to equate radicalization with anti-West, then you are in trouble, because we must radicalize Africa.
Dr. Kissinger's mission was also intended to resolve the crisis on South Africa's other flank, in Namibia, where guerrilla war has also begun.
Do you expect the guerrilla war in Namibia to intensify?
There's no doubt that if the South Africans don't move quickly to a constitutional conference, the guerrilla fighting in Namibia will be intensified, as it had necessarily to be intensified in Rhodesia.
And is it your view that at the moment South Africa doesn't seem to be inclined to move quickly towards a constitutional conference?
I have a feeling that the South Africans have not, in the case of Namibia, accepted the facts of life.
Just before Dr. Kissinger went to see Mr. Vorster, your government expressed anxiety, saying that for Dr. Kissinger to meet a man whom you describe as a butcher would give Vorster respectability in the eyes of the world. Are you, though, now glad that Dr. Kissinger met Mr. Vorster?
It doesn't stop him from being a butcher. He's a butcher. There is no some sacramental exercise which is going to stop Vorster from being a butcher. The man is a butcher, and he knows it himself, and the world knows it. Vorster has changed in relation to Rhodesia. He accepts majority rule in the case of Rhodesia. He does not accept anything like majority rule. He doesn't accept any change leading to a relaxation of apartheid in South Africa at all.
How now do the frontline states, assuming the independence of Rhodesia, how do the frontline states help the majority population of South Africa?
We'll go on explaining to the rest of the world the meaning of apartheid. And we hope the outside world will understand why the majority of the people in South Africa cannot tolerate that situation. They'll oppose it, they'll be shot, there are going to be more and more Sowetos, and we hope the outside world will understand that this has nothing to do with communism. It only has to do with apartheid and people fighting against apartheid. We'll continue doing this.
Do you believe that the life of apartheid has been shortened as a consequence of Dr. Kissinger's shuttle?
I don't believe myself. Dr. Kissinger has made a statement on apartheid. He has condemned apartheid itself. But I don't believe his shuttle will have the slightest impact on South Africa itself. Certainly not directly. But if Kissinger's and the Americans' diplomacy and pressure helps to liberate Namibia and Rhodesia, South Africa now will have on its borders independent Africa. And the fact that South Africa is bordering directly on independent Africa, irrespective of the ideology or the degree of radicalization of the governments which border South Africa, this is bound to have a tremendous effect on what happens within South Africa itself. So, to that extent, what the Americans are doing now will indirectly affect, in the long run, what is happening in South Africa.